Okay, ready? Okay, the formal part of it. Yes, let's go.
A very good evening to the cheerful audience. I, Nidhi Baghel, welcome you all to this session of Orange City Literature Fest 2020. This session is on lost recipes of India with Chef Aditya Bal in conversation with Arwa Ahmed. Our speaker, Chef Aditya Bal, he has been hosting and anchoring with over a decade of experience in the culinary field from award-winning cookery shows on NDTV, Epic, and TLC HD to running his own food startups, from writing cookbooks to setting up food and beverage projects. Chef Aditya Bal has enjoyed every element of his journey. In everything, he try and infuse passion and enthusiasm into his work. At present, he has just launched his Kolkata-based food startup called Delhi Kebab House, where he has brought the flavors of Mughlai and Punjabi cooking of North India to the city's food lovers. Our moderator, Arwa Ahmed, has grown up in Dubai, but spent 9 years in the US for her undergraduate and master's education at the Wharton School, University of Pennsylvania, and then her management consulting life in New York. When she returned to Dubai in 2010, she started a food blog called I Live in a Frying Pan, which eventually transformed into her current food tour business. Arwa Ahmed founded Frying Pan Adventures, Dubai's first licensed food and culture tourism company, in 2013. Driven by her hunger to show people the authentic side of the city she had grown up in. Along with her sister, Farida, she's also the co-host of UAE's first ever dedicated food podcast, Deep Fried. I'm sure we are going to have a great and delicious session. I now hand over to the moderator, Arwa Ma'am. Over to you.
Thanks, Nidhi. Chef Aditya, such a pleasure and an honor to be speaking with you today.
No, the honor is all mine. And I must say thank you, by the way, for that wonderful introduction, by the way. And I'm most intrigued by Arwa, by, you know, this food tours that you're doing in Dubai. I mean, that's something that must be super interesting as well.
It is, but yeah. What I'm actually more interested in is the tour that you're doing right now. So before we even get started on the conversation, I know right before we went live, you just mentioned that you've been on a journey from Kolkata to now you're in Goa. So you're on the road during these crazy pandemic times. What on earth are you doing? Just let's pause and just answer that.
with all possible social distancing and all the precautions. Actually, this is something that I'm looking to do some work here, start up some work here, some project work, as well as I would say discovering some more cuisine this side. But I'm also kind of getting into the I would say content creation, food content creation of my own, finally, after many years of kind of just working and being involved with the F&B business part of it. These last year or so, you know, has actually given me time, like I'm sure it's given a lot of us time to reassess things, to see where they're going. And also, I think it's almost become necessary to take to kind of integrate more with this digital age and that way of working. So once been driving. I really enjoy driving long distance. I can actually do very long distances. I have that kind of ability, I think, over the years. And we've driven 2500 km. We're here, and then we'll see where we go from here further. Just kind of trying to find some inspiration at the end of what's been a challenging year, you know, for us all. Just trying to find that inspiration going.
And I hear you. I mean, this is the year when a lot of people are exploring the content that they should have created for the last 10 years plus. And suddenly now is the year where like, okay, we have this time. Let's just get it done. You know, there's no excuse at the end of the year.
I think so. And also a lot of people have actually, you know, this space has grown.
Yes.
And it's almost like I kind of joke about this, that, you know, it's like I come from a classical kind of old school, you know, I would say almost generation. So I am kind of like all about, like, you know, cook for a living, just keep cooking for a living, and like, you know, one business into the other, you know, one doesn't work, start again. But now the game, I believe the game has kind of moved on a bit. Of course, food will always be integral to the business, and people will always consume food. But content itself has become of great value.
Yes.
And a great way of you know, pushing whatever you're doing as well. So it's a good avenue for everyone, anyone. And it's pretty easy to do. It's, you know, you can do it regardless of where you are, as long as you have some decent, I think, internet connectivity, maybe even a basic phone, almost anyone can create. So it's great fun to have, to be able to create your own content and, you know, play around with it, see what comes out.
Yes.
So I'm quite excited. It's like a new, yet another, you know, another chapter.
Absolutely. I think there's no better time than now to say that content is king, because the virtual appetite for the global appetite for these kinds of things has just skyrocketed this year. And the beauty of creating your own content is then you're not just limited to the place you live in, the country you live in, you're pretty much accessing the world, which brings me to the series that you are hosting, which is Lost Recipes, and which is the title of this session. I'm very curious about how you decided to go with Lost Recipes, because a lot of people that I meet tend to be people who are really into either evolving dishes, or, you know, there's a lot of let's import from place X into where we are and get a little taste of something that's far away. But you've decided that you're going to sort of rewind and go back in time and hunt out these old forgotten recipes. Why that approach?
Well, you know, at the outset, I'd like to say that I've just been, you know, I'm just very fortunate to actually have been, you know, part of these and this series. I think most of the credit really goes to, I would say, the channel and the producers. My director, producer as well, you know, the people who actually kind of really brought this concept and kind of believed in kind of doing a pilot episode way back in 2013.
Wow.
Well, yeah, so we've done two seasons now. So, you know, like I said, I mean, I personally didn't really kind of come up with this myself. It was more like, you know, here's an idea, why don't we see if it's even possible to do. And of course I was like, I'd be more than you know, I'd be very glad to do that. So in fact, it started here in Goa itself. 2013 we did the pilot episode, and then we, of course, then the channel approved it, and we got on it. So like I said, I mean, I personally I just feel that I'm very like fortunate to have been part of it, and a lot of the credit really goes to the creative minds behind it. So I think there was people at the channel, but I think mostly also it was the production house people I've worked with for many years. So yeah, and the director, she's actually the one who does the hard-nosed research. She's become a great expert at it, because I have to tell you, it was not easy finding all these communities. So I'm just a conduit. I'm like the last end of everyone's, you know, one part of everyone's effort. It's a completely collective
Absolutely, but you do an effortless job of bringing it on screen. But you do a fantastic job of packaging everything together, all of that research, all of, you know, all of the thought and the passion that goes behind. You are the face of the show at the end of the day, and I think you do a great job of bringing it to the front. And what better person to pick than someone who enjoys being on the road? Because the kinds of recipes you're looking at, I mean, the point of it being called lost recipes is these are recipes that are truly lost. They're forgotten. They're buried. They are not easily accessible. From what I've seen on your show, a lot of the people who are even making these recipes, it's really the first time they might be making it, or they, you know, maybe there's a previous generation that made it. They have not touched this recipe in forever. It's right. Like covered in dust in some cases. Who knows? It's changed so much. So, you know, what is your team's starting point? How do you guys even go about figuring out that this is a lost recipe when it's not even there to begin with?
You know, I think basically it starts with getting in touch with people from various communities, sub-communities, and like, for example, a community like the Parsis of the Parsi community, for example.
Yes.
You know, but of course, Parsis are in large across many parts of our country. But we thought of Udwada, which is in Gujarat, where, you know, which is literally like the, which is where the sacred fire is in India. You know, the Iran Shah, what you call it. You know,
right.
So that's like kind of a sacred. It's a sacred place for Parsis in our country, Udwada in Gujarat. So naturally, we would get in touch with someone over there and then ask them literally to think of recipes which maybe so they also need to research. They also, some people have recipes, some people need to kind of literally ask and kind of do research on their end to kind of find recipes which are lost. So that's really how we you know, go about it. But it really starts with connecting with people and then kind of really asking them. So we again very fortunate to have people who were kind enough to, like, you know, find those recipes, because but you know, there are people who love their communities and food is to do with the culture. So,
yes.
And history, in this case, you know, you're able to get a sense of their history as well. It's all research based, just getting in touch with people across communities.
It's like being a culinary archaeologist, right? Where you're sort of digging and digging and digging and digging until you hit on something. And
it is a lot of that.
And you know, from one of the episodes that I watched, I think you had an anthropologist as well on that show, where he said his name was Dr. Kurush Dalal, and he mentioned that, you know, sometimes some of these recipes are forgotten or lost because they're so complicated. Nobody has the time, no one has the patience now to be able to replicate some of these steps. So my question to you is, what are the two most complicated dishes or the two most complicated techniques that you have come across during your time doing this show? If you can share a little bit of the delicious details that go into those dishes.
Yeah. So one that I always, that we all remember out of more than many others, and of course there have been many extremely complex recipes on this series in the two seasons, but I think by far one that we all remember for the fact that it took about 12 to 14 hours to film and cook.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, but the amazing thing was that the lady who was cooking it sat through all 12 and 14 hours of it.
And what, did the team have their bistar there? So did you just pass out and then you're like, okay, we'll wake up and...
No. So this was, this was way back, like, again, I think 2014, probably in Lucknow, and it was winter around the 20th of December.
Oh, wow.
We were fortunate enough to be shooting, to be doing this with the Nawab of Lucknow, and him and his wife, you know, really, really sweet couple and very, very lovely people. And she, you know, was just like, she wouldn't like, you know, take any shortcuts or any of that. And of course, being the Nawab's house, it wasn't like we'll make this much. It was like, we're making normal.
I mean, if you're making it for 12 hours, then who's going to make a single serving? Then you may as well make enough for an army.
Exactly, exactly. So, yeah, so it was that famous Moti Palau, which is basically a very, very old Mughlai recipe. And it's just really hard to make. Because it starts with, you know, lamb, basically taking lamb, sheep, lamb's intestines, and then, you know, filling it with meat, and then tying it up, and then boiling them, and then cutting them. So you get these kind of white pearl kind of scenarios, and then making an entire palau, which of course, when you're doing it with a Mughlai way, it's a proper palau. It's not like how, you know, it's not any shortcut kind of a method.
So what's a proper palau in your opinion? When you say a proper palau, what do you mean?
A proper palau is where first and foremost, you know, if the proportion of liquid to the rice has to be exactly perfect, whatever else you want to put in that, that rice has to come out exactly perfect, absorbing exactly that amount of liquid and all of the flavors that you put into it, according to me. And of course, you can give a dum to a palau also, as in that's, you know, this was also cooked sealed on top. So it was dum karke. So once the liquid is absorbed by the rice, then the rest of it is just, the rice then after that just steams and kind of relaxes. And so everything comes out like incredibly khila hua, you know, the rice. And so clearly she also, you know, being... you know, Lucknow, that way they are extremely particular about their way of cooking, and you can see that there. You know, it's in the blood, it's in the DNA. So there's no way that they're not going to take a proper handi, which is, you know, a wide around the edges, around the sides, so that the rice is going to phulo. I mean, these are these little things. I mean, I think a lot of people who want to cook like these kind of dishes need to understand that the first thing is that you need to have the right shape of vessel if you want that result.
So
she did that, and then of course every ingredient in that, there was mutter in it, peas also, but those were also to be cooked separately in a masala. Ye nahi ke ji saath mein dal diya. I mean, in the house, if you make a mutter ka pala, like a peas palao,
and then throw everything in one pot,
to basically you'll just throw it all into one pot. But you know, she being so, that tarika and that taur tarika that she showed us. And that, so to answer your question, it just takes time. These recipes, they take hours sometimes, right? And that's what we don't want to put in anymore. We can't put in anymore. And that's why recipes like this have kind of been lost through time. I mean, people just don't make them. And as a result, people forget, you know, they don't make it from generation to generation. I mean, after I just keep thinking that what happens once these people kind of are no more, recipes, if nobody takes it forward, it goes with them, you know? So we remember that. I remember that palau, and of course there are many, many others, which are extremely complex recipes, which most of them take a long time to do, and they take very specific ingredients and a lot of effort to do them. There's no shortcut cooking. So yeah, I gave an example of that palau to people a lot.
Love that.
Yeah.
You know, it reminds me of this this dish we make in Hyderabad. My mom had gifted me for one of my birthdays. She gifted me this book by this lady called Mrs. Khan, who everyone had, you know, Mrs. Khan's recipes. And one of those desserts involved interacting with the mist, the morning mist.
Yes, yes. Of course,
you know,
that is
and I think
the Daulat ki chaat, they call it.
Exactly, exactly. And it's these kinds of things that we've lost the time, the patience, the whatever else. Like we've really regressed in that way. Sometimes we think we've evolved, but I think we've actually lost a lot of that ability to just cook based on intuition and really interact with nature. Anyway, I want to ask you actually about weird ingredients. So have you ever come across a recipe where they used to use, you're aware that they used to use a certain ingredient, but now that ingredient is simply no longer available, or at least not in that vicinity anymore?
So recently we were in Vishakhapatnam doing some coastal Andhra recipe, and chef over there who was kind enough, so we're doing these prawns which are marinated with tamarind leaves and tamarind leaves and some spices, and then wrapped in teak leaves, teak trees. So they are
right.
So I asked him, of course we asked him, why is this lost? He said, well, it takes a couple of days just to get the various leaves together, just to kind of wrap them and give them, and because that also gives it a flavor. So I would say, of course, teak leaves are available, but it's not something that you would kind of like be like, okay, I'm just going outside and picking some teak leaves and coming back.
Just getting them from the backyard. No, that's not happening.
Yeah, and also there was another recipe called umbario, which is a Parsi recipe, which involves just very, very seasonal ingredients from that very first harvest, so little garlic chives and little potatoes and even the country chicken, and then of course the local fenny of that tadi of the area, the toddy with which they put it all together. So again, a lot of the recipes just have extremely kind of localized ingredients and ingredients that are only available a certain time of the year. So I would think that most of these ingredients would be really tough to get your hands on for anyone if they just wanted to.
Absolutely.
Lots of ingredients like that.
Yeah, because we've moved so far away from growing. I mean, most people have. I know there are some incredible people who still grow their own food, but most of us have moved so far away from that to be able to understand an ingredient to that extent where you're looking at the differences in the harvest and using that ingredient accordingly, that really requires you to be growing your own vegetables.
Yeah, I mean, as a species, 90% of us have actually lost complete touch with this kind of real cycle of seasonal,
yes,
natural ingredients and the role that they play in your cooking. And that's something that when we go and we work with these people and they're cooking for us and we're just marveling at what ingredients they're using, because it's something that's just from the area, or it's something from a tree, something growing, and you're like, my God, but why was it made? And it's like, that's how they were made. I mean, at one point, that was the way people produced their food in their homes. It wasn't about mass-produced produce, bulk produce. So yeah, a lot of these things have changed. And that's why hundreds and thousands of varieties of grains and all have just died out over the last 50 years. Worldwide, grains and vegetables, and they've just died out, right? And they've been replaced by a much smaller number of mass.
Yes. High yielding stuff.
Produce. Yes. Yeah. Correct.
So if there was one dish that you could pick from across the show that you think would be worthy of the world's best restaurant, I don't want to take any names of which this restaurant is. I don't want to say Michelin star, even though I just said it. But imagine this. If there's one dish that could be, placed on that global pedestal, which dish do you think it would be?
Wow, that's a tough one. But look, so in Hyderabad, we were lucky enough to shoot at that famous palace of Jahanuma Palace in Hyderabad. Falaknuma.
Palace.
So there we came across this recipe called Ash.
Yeah.
think, do you know of Ash? Do you know what, have you ever heard of
it? You know, I did watch that episode. Actually, the Ash that I know of is a Persian dish. It's a
yes,
soup.
So this is Persian, without a doubt.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Being from Hyderabad, I've never had it in Hyderabad. So tell us more about it.
Well, it's very, very simple in its, I was simple by handful of ingredients, just a whole lot of mutton and cooked with salt and badi elaichi, like brown cardamoms.
Mm-hmm.
But basically the idea is that meat is just boiled with these spices, just these two spices till the time they release all. So it's like a shorba, like a consomme actually, in a way. But what happens is that they cook it for an hour, then they remove the spices, and then they add back fresh spices to it, then cook it for another hour, then take out the spices, then add fresh again. Then so like wow. That they do it for 7 hours continuously till all the essence of the meat is kind of drawn out into this broth.
It
becomes extremely gelatinous and flavorful, and then that is then strained and then further reduced down, and then the meat which is left is really like extremely kind of, I would say, extremely tender, just
shredded. Right.
And that's served with a chandi and sone ka bark. They put on it, and then they put this little consomme in on this soup plate, and the meat on the top, and then this with this gold leaf. So why I say it makes, it can find its way to a Michelin star restaurant is exactly that it's an ancient recipe, but it's been made super refined, and that's how the Nizam of Hyderabad was, right? I mean, he was known for his love of fine cuisine, and he helped taking Hyderabad's cuisine to an extremely high level. I mean, that's what he did. He invested in chefs from all over the world. He had chefs from French courts, from the courts of France working for him. And at the same time, the aristocrats in France took cooks from him, from here, to kind of, so that there was that whole thing going on. There was this almost one-upmanship kind of scenario.
Wow.
And
that's a real commitment.
Yeah. So I think that that dish for its presentation and its refinement would find its way straight away.
Well, let's hope that I can hunt it out when I go back to Hyderabad. I feel like I've missed out all these years, never having tried the dish. Yeah.
I don't know where you'd actually find it, because I have never myself come across it anywhere commercially. But yeah. if you went to that hotel, you could definitely like ask them if they could make it. I'm sure they'd be happy to. I think they do that if people are interested.
Actually, order that dish. I want to come back to this idea of, how to access some of these recipes going forward. But first, I'm actually curious about whether any of these recipes, these techniques have actually influenced your own cooking and how.
Of course, they were, even before Lost Recipes, when we were traveling around for some other shows we were doing, I'm talking about quite some time ago, we were coming across, techniques which were unusual. For example, clay smoked dishes, and even cooking wrapped in banana leaves and coconut husk, and using certain elements like that to actually cook the food, steam the food, bake the food. We were coming across recipes like that. So, personally, if I had my way, I would be doing all of my cooking like that, to be really honest, like just taking some dry leaves and making a parcel of something and bunging it in and letting it cook in those natural kind of, aromas and flavor compounds.
Right.
So greatly it influences what I've done. It's just that, again, in a practical day-to-day basis, I think you can't use all of those elements. You have to find a way of striking a balance. And also, I think one has to be environmentally conscious now. That's the one thing I feel that is probably not that we now need to look at a lot more, you know. There was a time when I was like, let's just cook everything on wood or cook everything coal fired. But I realized that now there's a responsibility towards the environment, which is probably greater than maybe just, you know, being a purist on flavor. But when one can, I love cooking on wood and coal. And
like, yeah, I the said, flavor of that is yeah.
Yeah. For example, in a pit, like, you know, you have all of these khad recipes, whether it's in Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh, we've done. So, but then, of course, you can't be that, I would say, you can't do it all the time.
Absolutely. Special occasion cooking. Yeah.
Yes.
So, Chef Aditya, we're getting some questions from the audience. And one of them is sort of related to a question that I have for you as well, which is, you know, how should we as Indians sort of preserve these recipes going forward? Because you've obviously, you've contributed by making this video series along with your team. What else are you planning to do to be able to solve this issue and in terms of losing these recipes? And how do we as a broader community support that?
That's a really good question. I think first and foremost, it's really important that people, when you have your family recipes, right? Everyone's home eventually will have recipes that are lost, so to speak, right? From home to home. So you might have one in your home right now. You know, I definitely have some. Everyone's homes have, you know, your grandmother's cooking, even your mother's cooking, or your father's, it could be anyone. And they're bringing down recipes that they've learned from generations before. And I think it's the best way to preserve them is to learn more about them and take up your, you know, whether you cook them or not, at least codify them. I mean, put them down, you know. And in fact, now it's even easier, just shoot them on a phone, you know, document them for yourselves, because who knows, one day you may you know, miss those recipes, you know. Where it's a, like I said, I mean, it's a tradition. So I think the best way to preserve them would be to that all of us in our homes and which in a personal way are able to kind of do whatever we can to at least make sure that somebody is able to document them, either in writing or today make a video of it and keep them away. That would be, of course, the most obvious way. And the other would be, I think, it's you know, if people genuinely encourage and join cooking with their family members, you know, with their mothers and fathers and grandparents, if they're still lucky enough to have maybe grandparents around doing the cooking, then, you know, the best way is to encourage and to show that encouragement and then, you know, hopefully be able to preserve those recipes. So we just brought it to people's notice. I think through the show we were able to again bring it to people's notice that there are these wonderful recipes. But I think these recipes exist in all of our homes, so best way to preserve them is to just look at your own home cooking and your own family recipes as potentially one day lost. So make sure you all write them down, make those recipe books, make those videos, put them away, so that one day, you know, you're able to pass them on to your kids and the next generations. It's part of our tradition.
No. And have a ridiculously delicious meal at the end of all of that.
Yeah, absolutely. Without a doubt, I think 50 years from now, even the food we cook now will be like incredibly special, because I think the way things are going, who knows what food is like 50 years from now, you know?
Absolutely, yeah.
It's, I think, a great way, really important to preserve our heritage, and food is part of our
absolutely heritage.
I think it's not removed from it. Yeah, just write them down.
Yeah, and I love what you say about using this as an opportunity to get the family together, because actually some of these recipes they cannot be done with just one person on their own fumbling around in the kitchen. You require, it gives you that reason to get there with your grandmother doing whatever, you know, learning those. You have to do it firsthand. You need help to be able to execute some of these really complicated dishes. So it's just a beautiful, especially in this very, very challenging year for people where people are feeling very isolated. Maybe you're just at home, stuck with your family, ready to cut each other's throats. This is actually a great way, a very constructive way of getting people around a table and connecting on something that, you know, that gets the previous generation excited as well. I know that whenever I've seen my grandmother in the kitchen watching her cook, it's a very deeply fulfilling experience, not just for me watching her, but actually for her preparing something for me.
Yeah. That's, I mean, I think like exactly like you said, the best thing we can do is to show great interest and be involved with family cooking.
You know? Yes.
Okay, if we don't cook, doesn't matter. But I think for a cook and for people who are like, you know, for our folks and people who are, I mean, when you encourage a cook, they want to do more of it. So yeah, you're absolutely right.
And even for people who don't cook. No, sorry, go ahead.
No, I was saying it's a great way to, like I said, just encourage.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
cooks. And I would say even for people who don't cook, do not underestimate the power of tasting. Stand there and taste and give compliments. It is actually the biggest encouragement to someone who is cooking, especially from the previous generation.
Yeah, from all generations. Like I say, you know, cooks are only one part of it. Like, you know, the diner or the eaters are probably absolutely even more important, because, you know, we cook to feed, and then, you know, without them eating it, it's only cooking.
absolutely. It's that connection which makes it an experience. So I want to close out with a final question that came in from someone who's listening in. What are your expectations going forward from the show? What are you sort of hoping to get out of this going forward into the future?
Firstly, I would like to be out back on the road again as soon as it's possible, you know, to go out and again kind of connect with more communities and people and bring more recipes out back, you know, for our viewers. And personally, I would love to kind of get a chance to put this all down into maybe a book, or if we can do it even digitally, maybe now that could work. But be able to document them, and also I think what a lot of people would like to know is how they could take them and make them adapt them to our kitchens, you know, adapt them to modern kitchens, maybe substituting certain ingredients. And things like that. I'd like to hopefully be able to explore some more and then get a chance to do some maybe book work on it. Because I think if there is some recipes definitely need to be kind of put down on paper.
Absolutely. Like, I'm not going to be able to replicate the Moti Pulao just by hearing you.
We'll need
a thesis on that recipe.
Yeah, and so many like that. And I think but it would also be something which would require a lot of contributions from everyone. Like I said, I mean, this is not one person thing. It's a multiple people. It belongs to everyone, right? The cooks, the families, the... So I think this would be something to do it justice. One would need to do it really carefully and make sure that everything is represented correctly, because it's again about people's history, culture and all of that. So, hopefully.
Well, thank you so much, Chef Aditya. We're going to be waiting for your book then to come out. And thank you for making us hungry and aware through your show. It was a pleasure speaking with you.
Thank you so much. It was a pleasure. Thank you so much. It was wonderful speaking with you. Hope one can get a chance to come down to Dubai and maybe, you know, you could take us on one of these tours.
That would be an honor.
No, it would be a pleasure. Thank you. Cheers.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you, Aditya sir and Arwal ma'am, for such an amazing session. I am sure our audience is now craving for such mouth-watering dishes that you just discussed. On behalf of the Orange City Literature Fest, I sincerely express our gratitude towards your acceptance for the session and knowledge shared with us. Special thanks to SGR Knowledge Foundation. Here we come to an end of the three-day event of the Orange City Literature Fest 2020. After hearing our great speakers and gaining knowledge from their sessions, let's refresh ourselves and join for a mesmerizing musical evening by the great Mame Khan. Thank you all for making your valuable presence. I wish you have a fun-filled evening ahead. And not to be forgotten, mark the date of Orange City Literature Fest Season 3. It's 26th, 27th and 28th of November 2021. So see you all next year. Till then, stay happy, stay safe.
Twenty years of existence. Two universities. 23 educational institutes. Offering 137 courses. Thy Sony Group of Institutions. A vision beyond.